Let us see some important equations in the chapter gravitation to solve objective type questions in this chapter. The first point you have to note in this case is Newton's law of gravitation. Newton's law of gravitation. Consider two masses, M1 and M2. Separated by a distance r. The force of attraction between M1 and M2 is directly proportional to the product of their masses. That force is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. Therefore, we can say that F proportional to M1 M2 by r square, or F is equal to G M1 M2 by r square. G is called universal gravitational constant. Universal gravitational constant. The value of G is 6.67 into 10⁻¹ⁱ Newton meter square per kilogram square. The value of G was first experimentally noted by the scientist Cavendish. Now you have to see what is the dimension of G. From this equation, we can say that G is equal to FR square divided by M1 M2. F, the dimension is ML⁻². R square is L square. M means M, therefore capital M square. Solving this, we get the dimension of G is M⁻¹ L cube T⁻². The dimension of G is M⁻¹ L cube T⁻². The unit of G is Newton meter square per kilogram square. You will get that unit from this equation. Force is Newton, distance is meter, mass is kilogram. Then Newton meter square per kilogram square. Now we have to see the characteristics of this gravitational force. First one is, it is a central force. It is always attractive in nature. It is a long range force. It is the weakest force operating in nature. This gravitational force is actually due to the exchange of gravitons. Last one is, this gravitational force does not depend on the medium between the masses. Then arise three important questions. First one, a mass M is split into two. It can be split in different ways. The force between them is maximum when? The force between the masses is maximum when it is split equally. The force between these two split masses is maximum when it is split equally. That is, the ratio of these masses is 1:1. Another important point is, there is a spherical shell of mass M. There is a small mass M at a distance small r from the center of the spherical shell. How we can calculate the force between these two masses? The force between the spherical shell and the small mass. It can be calculated like this. The whole mass M, we can say that the whole mass M is concentrated at its center and the small mass is at a distance r. Then you can calculate the force like this. F is equal to G capital M small m divided by r square. The whole mass of the spherical mass is concentrated. We can assume it concentrated at its center. then you can calculate the force between them. The force is like this, F is equal to gmm divided by r square. Another question is, suppose a small mass m is inside this spherical shell of mass capital M. What about the force acting on this small mass? We can calculate the force acting on this small mass m is equal to zero. Now we have to see the relation between small g and capital G. Small g equals capital Gm divided by r square, where m is the mass of earth. Capital R, the radius of the earth. The relation between small g and capital G is small g equals Gm by r square, where m is the mass of the earth, capital R, the radius of the earth. From this equation, we can say that G proportional to 1 by r square. Therefore, we can calculate the change in G like this. Delta G by G equals minus 2 into delta R by R. This is an important equation. Sometimes the question may ask like this. Suppose the radius of the earth shrinks by 1%. What is the percentage change in acceleration due to gravity? The percentage change in G can be calculated like this. The radius decreases by 1%. Then you can say that delta G by G equals minus 2 into minus 1. That means 2%. The answer is, when the radius of the earth decreases by 1%, acceleration due to gravity increases by 2%. When the radius of the earth decreases by 1%, the acceleration due to gravity increases by 2%. Another important equation is density of earth. Density of earth, D equals mass by volume. The mass can be calculated using this formula, G is equal to Gm by R square. That is, M is equal to Gr square divided by G. We consider the earth as a sphere. Therefore, the volume is 4 by 3 pi r cube. Solving, we get D equals 3g divided by 4 pi capital R capital G. Density of the earth, D equals 3g divided by 4 pi capital R capital G. Now we have to see the variation of G with altitude. Suppose we take a point at a height h above the surface of the earth. The acceleration due to gravity at that point is given by G dash equals G into 1 minus 2h by r. This is actually an approximate relation, where r is the radius of the earth. The actual relation is, at a height h above the surface of the earth, acceleration due to gravity g dash equals gm divided by r plus h the whole square. Next is variation of g with the depth. Suppose we take a point at a depth d from the surface of the earth. The value at that point is given by g dash equals g into 1 minus d by r. Solving, we get g dash equals g into r minus d divided by r. R minus d, this is r, this is d, therefore this distance is taken as small r. Therefore g dash equals g into r divided by r. That is g dash proportional to r. This is an important equation. Suppose we take the center of the earth. Here, at the center, small r equals 0. Therefore, acceleration due to gravity g dash equals 0. That is, at the center of the earth, acceleration due to gravity equals 0. As distance increases, acceleration due to gravity increases linearly. Up to the surface of the earth. Now, we have to see the graphical representation of variation of g with height or depth. Above the surface of the earth, the variation of g is just like this. It is a curve just like this. Below the surface of the earth, it is a straight line. From this graph, we can say that at the center of the earth, acceleration due to gravity equals 0. As distance increases, acceleration due to gravity increases, and on the surface, acceleration due to gravity is maximum. Now we have to study what is the effect of rotation of the earth on the value of g. The variation is just like this. Acceleration due to gravity g dash equals g minus r omega square cos square phi, where omega is the angular velocity of the earth. Phi is the latitude angle. Latitude angle means angular distance from the equator. You know that at the equator, latitude angle phi equals 0. Therefore, this equation becomes cos 0 equals 1. Therefore, g dash equals g minus r omega square. At the poles, phi is equal to 90 degree. Therefore, cos 90 equals 0. Therefore, g dash equals g. Then we can say that acceleration due to gravity is greater at the poles than at the equator. Acceleration due to gravity is greater at the poles than at the equator. Suppose the earth stops rotating. What happens to the acceleration due to gravity at the equator? Suppose the earth stops rotating. What happens to the acceleration due to gravity at the equator? You know that at the equator, acceleration due to gravity g dash equals g minus r omega square. Suppose the earth stops rotating, omega equals 0, therefore g dash equals g. That means when the earth stops rotating, acceleration due to gravity increases by a factor r omega square. If the earth stops rotating, acceleration due to gravity increases by a factor r omega square.
Integral, an institution for innovative teaching. Medical and Engineering Entrance Coaching, CPTCA Entrance, Crash Course, Private Tuitions, Brain Development Program for Children from 3 to 14 years, Integral, Galaxy Building, Kattanam, 944-75-666-83, 944-71-05-465.
What happens to the weight of a body at a height h equals r, the radius of the earth? We consider a point P at a height h equals r from the surface of the earth. What about the weight of the body? The weight, acceleration due to gravity g dash equals gm divided by r plus h the whole square. The weight mg dash equals gmm divided by r plus h the whole square. When h is equal to r, the weight becomes 25% as that on the surface of the earth. That is, at a height h is equal to r, the weight of the body becomes 25%. Now we have to study some of the concepts in artificial satellites. Man-made satellites made to revolve around the earth or any other planet are called artificial satellites. Now we have to study the concept of orbital velocity. Suppose a satellite revolves around the earth in an orbit of radius r. A satellite of mass small m revolves around the earth of mass m in an orbit of radius r. The orbital velocity vo equals root of gm by r, where r is the radius of the orbit. Suppose that satellite is at a height h above the surface of the earth. Then small r can be written as capital R plus h. This is radius of the earth. Then orbital velocity vo equals root of gm by r plus h. Suppose the satellite is revolving very close to the surface of the earth. Then h almost equal to 0. Then orbital velocity vo equals root of gm by r. But you know that gm equals gr square. Therefore, orbital velocity vo equals root of gr square divided by r. That is, orbital velocity equals root of gr. Its value is 7.9 km per second. That is, if a satellite revolves very close to the surface of the earth, the orbital velocity is approximately 7.9 km per second. This velocity is called first cosmic velocity. This velocity is called the first cosmic velocity. Now we have to study, what about the equation for period of a satellite? Period means time taken for one revolution. We can theoretically prove that period of the satellite t is equal to 2 pi into root of r cube divided by gm. T is equal to 2 pi into root of r cube divided by gm, where r is the radius of the orbit, m is the mass of the earth. Approximately, we can say that t is equal to 2 pi into root of r by g. That is, the satellite is revolving very close to the surface of the earth. Then small r becomes capital R. Gm equals gr square. Solving, we get period t equals 2 pi into root of r by g. T is equal to 2 pi into root of r by g. You might have studied the concept of geostationary satellites or synchronous satellites. You know that these satellites are mainly used for communication purpose. The important points you have to note for geostationary satellite is the period of that geostationary satellite is 1 day. That means it is same as that of the earth. It should revolve in the equatorial plane from west to east. The height of the geostationary satellite is approximately 36,000 kilometer. Orbital speed of the satellite should be 3.1 kilometer per second. These are the important points regarding geostationary satellite. Period is 1 day. It should revolve in the equatorial plane from west to east. The height of the geostationary satellite is 36,000 kilometer. It is mainly used for communication purpose. Yes, now we have to study some concepts of polar satellites. You know that the polar satellite revolves across the poles of the earth. It is revolving very close to the surface of the earth. The height of polar satellites is about 900 kilometers from the surface of the earth. These polar satellites are actually used for studying environmental surface properties of earth. Each orbit makes 100 minutes and it makes 14 orbits a day. It covers the entire surface of the earth twice a day. It is actually used for environmental studies. These polar satellites are used, are revolving very close. Now we have to study the concept of escape velocity. That is escapism from gravitational pull. You know that it is the velocity with which a body should be projected. It is the minimum velocity with which a body should be projected so that it may go beyond the gravitational pull of the earth. We can theoretically prove that escape velocity V equals root of 2gm divided by capital R, where m is the mass of the earth and capital R the radius of the earth. But you know that gm equals gr square. Solving, we get escape velocity equals root of 2gr. Its value is about 11.2 km per second. It is called a second cosmic velocity. When you compare orbital velocity and escape velocity, we can approximately say that V equals root 2 VO. Escape velocity is root 2 times the orbital velocity. Then arise another question. What about third cosmic velocity? It is the velocity with which a body should be projected so that it may go beyond the solar system. We can theoretically prove that its value is about 16.75 km per second. Now we have to study the what is the concept of weightlessness in orbit. A person orbiting in a satellite feels no weight. That concept is called weightlessness in orbit. Now we have to study the concept of intensity of gravitational field. We consider a mass m and we take a point P at a distance r. Intensity of gravitational field F is equal to gm by r square. That is, we take a point P, intensity of gravitational field at this point is given by F is equal to gm by r square. Next is gravitational potential. You know that gravitational potential is the work done in bringing a unit mass from infinity to that point. Gravitational potential is given by V is equal to minus gm by r. We consider a mass m and we take a point P at a distance r from the mass. The gravitational potential at that point is given by V is equal to minus gm by r. The maximum value of gravitational potential is zero. the maximum value of gravitational potential is zero at infinity. The maximum value of gravitational potential is zero at infinity. Now we have to study what is the equation for gravitational potential energy on the surface of the earth. Suppose a mass m is placed on the surface of the earth. Its gravitational potential energy is minus gmm divided by capital R. Suppose this mass is taken from the surface of the earth to a height h. Increase in gravitational potential energy can be written as gmm into 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Here r1 is on the surface of the earth, capital R. R2 is capital R plus h. Therefore, the increase in gravitational potential energy is gmm into 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Suppose this mass is taken from the surface of the earth to a height h. Then r1 equals capital R, r2 equals r plus h. Now we have to study the equation for energy in orbital motion. Suppose a satellite revolves around the earth. It possesses kinetic energy, it possesses potential energy, therefore it possesses total energy. Kinetic energy in orbital motion is given by gmm divided by 2r. Potential energy in orbital motion is minus gmm divided by r. Total energy is kinetic energy plus potential energy equals minus gmm divided by 2r, where r is the radius of the orbit. There is a shortcut for this. If kinetic energy is k, potential energy is minus 2k and total energy is minus k. The shortcut is, if kinetic energy is k, potential energy is minus 2k and total energy is minus k. Now we have to study the laws of planetary motion. You know that every planet moves around the sun in an elliptical orbit, not in circular orbit. Every planet moves around the sun in an elliptical orbit. Second one, aerial velocity of this planet is a constant. Aerial velocity means the line joining sun to planet sweeps out equal areas in equal intervals of time. That means aerial velocity is a constant. This law is obtained from the law of conservation of angular momentum. The meaning is Kepler's second law is obtained in accordance with the law of conservation of angular momentum. When the planet is very close to the sun, that point is called perigee. When the planet is away from the sun, that point is called apogee. We can write a formula like this. Vp Rp equals Va Ra. Vp means velocity at perigee. Va means velocity at apogee. Rp, the distance of sun from the planet. Ra, distance of sun from the planet when it is at apogee. From that we can say that velocity at perigee greater than velocity at apogee. Velocity at perigee greater than velocity at apogee. Third law is the square of the period of revolution of the planet is directly proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis. The square of the period of the planet is directly proportional to cube of the semi-major axis. That is t square proportional to r cube. This is a very important equation for solving problems. T square proportional to a cube. Now we have to note the solutions of the questions given. Question number 1. We have to find out the velocity of that object at infinity. You know that total energy is a constant. Then you can write it as total energy on the surface of the earth equals total energy at infinity. Total energy on the surface of the earth equals total energy at infinity. Total energy means kinetic energy and potential energy. Therefore, kinetic energy plus potential energy on the surface of the earth equals kinetic energy plus potential energy at infinity. Kinetic energy means half E square. Potential energy means minus GMM divided by R. At infinity, kinetic energy we write it as half MV1 square. You know that potential energy at infinity is zero. Solving these, we get V1 square equals V square into E square minus 2GM divided by R. You know that escape velocity V equals root of 2GM divided by R. Escape velocity V equals root of 2GM divided by R. Therefore, this term is actually V square. The velocity here given is 2 times escape velocity. Then this equation becomes 2V the whole square minus V square. That means 3V square. Therefore, V1 equals root 3V. Therefore, the answer for question number 1 is B. That is root 3 into 11.2 in kilometer per second. Now, we have to study the solution of question number 2. At a height h above the surface of the earth, g dash equals g into 1 minus 2h by r. At a depth d, g dash equals g into 1 minus d by r. So these two accelerations are the same. Therefore, we can equate like this. G into 1 minus 2h by r equals g into 1 minus d by r. From that, we can say that d equals 2h. Here, h is given as 5 kilometer. Therefore, d is equal to 2 into 5, that means 10 kilometers. Therefore, the answer for the question number 2 is B. Third question. You know that the relation between small g and capital G is equal to gm by r square. Mass means volume into density. Earth is considered as a sphere for calculation purpose. Therefore, volume means 4 by 3 pi r cube into d divided by r square. Solving, we get g proportional to rd. In the first case, g1 proportional to r1 d1. In the second case, g2 proportional to r2 d2. Therefore, g1 by g2 equals g1 by g2 equals g1 by g2 equals r1 by r2 into d1 by d2. Therefore, the question for the question 3, the answer is A. Fourth question. You know that if kinetic energy is K, potential energy is minus 2K. That is a standard result. Here potential energy V equals, you can write it as minus 2K. Therefore, the answer for question number 4 is D. Question number 5. Increase in gravitational potential energy can be written as GMM into 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Here R1 is capital R and R2 is R plus H. Here H is equal to R. Therefore, increase in gravitational potential energy is GMM into 1 by R minus 1 by 2R. Solving, we get it is equal to GMM divided by 2R. But GM equals GR square. But GR square into M divided by 2R. It is equal to mgr divided by 2. The answer for the question number 5 is C.